Joe Guzzardi is a syndicated editorial columnist for a number of publications and a senior writing fellow at Californians for Population Stabilization, which is known by its acronym of CAPS. He taught English as a second language in the Lodi, California School District for 23 years. He is also a member of the Society for American Baseball Research and the Internet Baseball Writers Association of America, and a very passionate baseball fan. So, Joe, you're up.
Thank you very much. And before I start, thanks to Casey and Nikki Calloway, who helped organize this very successful 40th Writers Workshop. Tremendous job, and you deserve a lot of credit for it. Also, thanks to all of the very skilled speakers who preceded me. Normally, it's tough to be the last speaker of the day, but luckily for you, and therefore luckily for me, I'm going to share with you a really heartwarming story about a defense of the American flag that was made 40 years ago that I'm sure is going to touch you all very deeply. And it's good timing because now, you know, every time you pick up the sport page or you turn on the sports news, you see something really depressing about Colin Kaepernick who won't, go through the proper respect for the American flag when the national anthem is played. And there have since been a whole bunch of copycat incidents. So I'm going to show you this video here in a few minutes. But before we get to that lofty and elevating moment, we're going to have to wallow briefly in baseball muck. So 2 years ago, I addressed this same group, and we talked a little bit about what has happened to baseball in the United States. Many of us here in this room grew up watching baseball, and we grew up watching Carl Yastrzemski and Willie Mays and Jackie Robinson and players like that. And when we've gone out to the ballpark in recent years, we've seen pretty much a different demographic group out on the field. Some 25 to 30% of the players in baseball today are foreign-born. And 2 years ago, we talked about who they are and how they got here. And after my presentation, many of you came up to me and had the timidity to ask when they might be going home. So I'll answer the last question first. They're not going home anytime soon, if ever. But basically what happened was during the George Bush administration, the first George Bush administration, the baseball owners with whom Bush was extremely friendly approached him and said, you know, George, we're having a terrible time getting enough Caribbean players up to the United States because the visa restrictions are just too difficult for us to live with. And since Bush had once been a partner in a Major League Baseball team, he was friendly with these guys, and he was, as he had been on all immigration issues, sympathetic to their arguments. So I don't know if it was a brand new visa, but the P visa was P for professional athlete is actually what it stands for. That visa was expanded, and an unlimited number of foreign-born baseball players, as well as some of the other professional sports, were allowed to come to the United States. And coincidentally, or not coincidentally, but at the same time, major league owners opened up professional baseball camps, mostly in the Dominican Republic. So now there's 30 major league baseball teams. All of the teams have camps in the Dominican Republic. So the owners are able to go down to the Dominican Republic, recruit heavily, and basically, if you're an American League Baseball owner and you wave $15,000 or $25,000 in front of a family, a Dominican family, and tell them that that's money that's going to be going to their young son, and he will, if everything works out well, get a green card to come to the United States legally. And in the meantime, he'll be fed and housed and so forth at this baseball camp, you're going to have a lot of interest in signing up. And that basically is what happened. Lots and lots and lots of Caribbean players, mostly from the Dominican, but also from Venezuela, have been signed up, and they have come to the United States to play. And just like with the H-1B visas, they have displaced American players. The argument is much the same. People say, well, these guys are so much more talented than American players. And I say, no, they're not. But they have been thrust into American baseball, and they've displaced Americans. Many, many, many hundreds of qualified baseball players graduate from major NCAA universities every year, and the most displaced have been black Americans. Most Major League Baseball teams now only have one or two black Americans on their squads, so they have suffered by far the most. So 2 years ago, the big push was Dominicans, and now if you're following the sport at all, you'll notice that there has been a huge influx of Cuban players into Major League Baseball, and hundreds of thousands of dollars have been given to these Cubans to sign. And there are hundreds more Cuban baseball players waiting in the wings to sign. So we're going to take a look here at a brief video that shows how this process gets underway and how it's getting started and how it's likely to evolve. But before we see it, I'll set the stage for you. We're in Havana, Cuba. It's March of this year. Obama is down in Cuba, kissing up to the communists at a baseball game between the Tampa Bay team, a Major League Baseball team, and the Cuban All-Stars. There's the President of the United States doing the wave with the communists, sitting next to the virulently anti-American Raul Castro. And remember, this is the day after the attack in Brussels, where 30-odd people were killed, including, I think, two or three Americans. Hundreds were injured. And reporters went up to Obama after the game and said, or before the game, I forget which, and said, well, you know, don't you think it's inappropriate for you to be attending a baseball game in a communist country when so many people have been victimized by a terrorist attack? And Obama, as he is so prone to do, said something that was wildly infuriating. He said, well, you know, really, my attendance at this baseball game shows that terrorists can't change the American way of life, and by my attending this game, we're fighting back against terrorism and, you know, similar kind of nonsense. But what was really going on behind the scenes here is this effort between the Cuban government, the U.S. government, and Major League Baseball, as represented by the bean-counting commissioner, Rob Manfred, to try to, as they put it, facilitate the arrival of more Cuban players into the United States to play baseball. And if you follow it at all, you would say, well, it seems to be facile enough to get to the United States and play baseball because there is an increasing number of American players in the game. So as these Cubans have arrived into the United States to play baseball, there have been some that have been really superstars, extremely talented players who have helped their teams. There have been some that have been average kinds of players, and there are some that have been huge busts. But I'm going to share one example with you that shows some of the difficulties of Cubans assimilating into the U.S. culture, and also shows how greedy the baseball owners are, the owners of the 30 baseball franchises. Basically, you have to think of them as the same kind of corporate tycoons as Apple or any other major corporation when it comes to maximizing profits. So This guy, Arnaldus Chapman, he's a pitcher. He's now with the Chicago Cubs, but he started out with the Cincinnati Reds. And he's very talented. He throws the baseball more than 100 miles an hour, which is exceptional. The average amount of time that it takes, baseball to leave a pitcher's hand and get to the catcher's mitt behind him. He's in the United States. It's off season. He's down in his Florida home. And he tries to strangle his girlfriend, or that's what the police report, her report. She alleges that he tries to strangle her. She escapes and is able to hide in the bushes outside of the house, where she calls the police on her cell phone. The police come to the house, and just before they arrive, he, either out of frustration because he wasn't able to strangle her, or other issues, had other issues, shoots up his garage. He fires his gun off something like, eight times, and completely shoots up his garage. So no charges were ever brought, which is very common in these kind of domestic abuse allegations that involve women and baseball players. Rarely, I can't think of a time when a charge has actually been put in. So the Reds want to get rid of him. They trade him for reasons not related to his domestic abuse charge, for baseball reasons involving money. The Reds trade him to the Yankees, and the Yankees go to trade him again. This is all in the same year. And so he lands with the Chicago Cubs. And at the time the Cubs acquired him, they already have a firm grip on first place. And although there would be some teams that would be in competition for him, or if he joined that team would help them get into the baseball playoffs, the Cubs are already almost guaranteed a spot to get into the playoffs. So what I said to myself while all of these rumors were floating around as to what team Chapman might land on, I'm thinking, well, why wouldn't the Cubs say, we don't really want this guy. He's got a very checkered past. We have young, impressionable fans. A lot of our fans are women. But they didn't say any of those things. They pretty much tripped all over themselves to sign Chapman. And now he's part of the team. And I don't really watch much baseball, but every time the Cub games are on, or there's a clip of the Cub games, they pan the stadium, and I see Chapman coming in, and all of the women fans in the stands are applauding. Here comes Chapman. And I just, we do a lot of head scratching in our business, and I'm thinking, wow, I'm really surprised that there could be so much enthusiasm for this player who has a record of domestic abuse, how there could be so many women fans in support of him. So the point is that Major League Baseball really doesn't care very much about what a person's character is. If they think that he's going to contribute to a pennant or World Series championship, which translates into a whole bunch of more money than they would otherwise earn, that's something that they're going to do. So now we're going to go back 40 years to 1976, when there was a much different attitude in America toward just about everything, including sports. And we're going to watch this video here. I'll set the scene for you. 1976. The Vietnam War is over. Technically it's over, but the emotions about the war, the feelings about the war, the hard feelings about the war are not over. Gerald Ford has pardoned Richard Nixon. There's a presidential race in progress, so there's a lot of raw emotions out there in the United States, and you're going to see evidence of it in this brief video clip.
There's an animal loose. Two of them. All right.
30 years later, I could not tell you immediately what was on my mind, except what they were doing was wrong. As far as I'm concerned, it was wrong in 1976. It's wrong today, what they were trying to do. The first match was struck, and as it was put to the flag, the wind blew it out, and I'm still running at them. The second match is ignited, and he starts to put, one of them starts to put the match to the flag at the same time I got there. I do know that I thought about maybe bowling them over, but now I can get the flag before maybe the match can get there. So I reached out, picked it up, still on the run. And the first thing that came to mind, I mean, you could smell the lighter fluid. That's how much they doused it. And it was soaking wet. You could feel the coldness of this lighter fluid. They said, well, is it on fire? Well, obviously it was not on fire. Thank goodness it was not on fire.
People don't notice, but he beat me to the flag. I was coaching third base at that time. And I saw Rick Money start running from center field over to left. I didn't know what it was, but as soon as I saw him stop, I took off and I ran out there.
Tommy Lasorda, remember, was the third base coach at the time for the Dodgers. It was the year before he became the manager, the year before I came to the Dodgers. Tommy ran past me yelling about every expletive a longshoreman has ever uttered in trying to get to the guys. I gave the flag to Doug Rao, who was a left-handed pitcher for the Dodgers, who came out of their third base dugout, and I gave him the flag. I turned around, the guys are being escorted off the field by members of the security team, and also Duke, the head groundskeeper, was with them too, and he had one of them by the arm, and they escorted them off the field. And it was a very quiet moment. There was a smattering of applause as they got these two guys off the field, and it got quiet again. And if memory serves correctly, from one part of the stadium, I don't know where, and then from another part, and then from another part, and then kind of collectively, people began to sing God Bless America. Don't know where it came from.
It was a very heroic move on his part in a situation that could have easily just let go. The flag could have easily just burned there until a couple of ushers came out. But Rick acted, and I think we're all very, very happy that he did.
I'm surprised by the response in the greatest sense of the word. Embarrassed by the intention that was focused upon me, because I don't know anyone who would not have done the same thing had they been as close to it as I was. So that being said, I get letters every week from retired servicemen, from their families, from kids who were not even born then that heard about it. And it started again a little bit more so a few years ago. Major League Baseball had selected that moment, saving the flag, as one of the top 100 moments in Major League Baseball history. So there was a rejuvenation of that entire thing.
Well, what he goes on to say is that he, you know, it's the proudest moment of his life. And a few other interesting things about this video clip. First of all, the two perpetrators out there, to this day, there's not all that much known about them. And it's kind of interesting because if that incident happened today, you know, those guys would be on talk radio every single day. You wouldn't be able to turn on your radio or TV without hearing them interviewed. But it's believed, it was first rumored that they were American Indians, but what is known for sure is that it was an unemployed man, about 37 or 8 years old, and his 12-year-old son. And the father spent a couple of days in jail, and that was pretty much the end of the publicity around the incident. Monday, the flag was seized by the police for evidence, but shortly after the case was, I don't know, thrown out or the police were done with it as a piece of evidence, it was given back to Monday, and he uses it now to this day to go around the United States and make speeches and raise money for veterans. And he's been offered $1 million for that flag. And he consistently turns that down. Now, you might think in the era of highly inflated baseball salaries that $1 million doesn't mean much to a professional athlete. But in his career, the most money that Rick Monday ever made was $200,000 a year. And as an entire career, he only made $550,000. So $1 million to Rick Monday would be a whole bunch of money. Monday was a slightly above average major league player. He was an outstanding baseball player at Arizona State University. And it's, you know, to his great credit that he acted swiftly and without any hesitation whatsoever to keep the flag from being burned. Just backing up a little bit, whenever I talk about this issue of foreign players coming into Major League Baseball, I make the point that, you know, playing baseball is a job. So when you're talking about a job that was once universally held by Americans and is now 30% foreign-born, you know, you're talking about U.S. kids, college kids, high school kids that don't have an opportunity at the what is not just a job, but the best job in the world. There's only 750 of those jobs. Minimum starting salary is $500,000 a year. Average players, $3, $5, $7 million a year. Above average players, $10, $12, $15 million a year. Superstars, $25 to $30 million a year. So it's no small thing that 30% of those jobs have displaced Americans and are going to foreign nationals. So if you were to go out, I don't know what teams you might root for, but if you were to go out to National Stadium or Yankee Stadium and say to the first 100 people that you see, have you ever stopped to think that playing baseball is a job and that all of these foreign-born players are displacing American players who may be every bit as qualified? And the other point that I like to make is that even if, I mean, I'm not saying that the players on the field aren't highly skilled and excellent players, but what I am saying is that if the average fan were to see, for example, a College World Series game, University of Texas versus UCLA, and you took those players out of their college uniforms and put them in uniforms that said Washington Nationals and Pittsburgh Pirates, the average fan would not be able to tell the difference. So the average fan, therefore, would not enjoy a game played by those players any less than you might enjoy going to a major league game. So, thank that's you. What I got. Sure, thank you, Casey. Thank you very much.